Good evening, everyone. We're going to get started. Thank you. Welcome to the first night of the high school conference here at the Reagan Ranch Center. I'd like to also extend an additional welcome to the thousands of people who are participating in this event tonight through YAF's Virtual Pass. If you're watching on YouTube or Facebook and not participating through Virtual Pass, head to yaf.org/virtualpass to submit questions for Michael Reagan to answer live after his lecture. Once you've logged into Virtual Pass, just enter your questions in the box on the right side of your screen. Michael is the son of former President Ronald Reagan and Academy Award-winning actress Jane Wyman. He authored many successful books, including his best-selling autobiography, On the Outside Looking In. His book, Twice Adopted, is based on his personal story. He is a popular national speaker on issues related to conservative politics, adoption, and the many life lessons he was taught by his parents. For 26 years, Michael hosted a nationally syndicated radio talk show, and he is also the founder and chairman of the Reagan Group. In addition to his role as president of the Reagan Legacy Foundation, he serves on the board of the John Douglas French Alzheimer's Foundation. In 2005, he established the Michael Reagan Center for Advocacy and Research in partnership with Arrow Child and Family Ministries. The center operates from a Christian worldview and conducts research in order to effectively advocate for public policies that benefit the safety, stability, and well-being of children and families. Michael and his wife have been married for 44 years and have two children, Cameron and Ashley. Please join me in welcoming Michael Reagan.
No, hug. I hug. Thank you. I've got water and everything. That's great. It's good to be here. How is everybody? That's great. I also have two grandchildren. I have a 3.5-year-old, Marilyn Page, who's named after Marilyn Monroe. And if you watch wrestling, the people would know who Page is. Anybody know who Page is, the wrestler from London? Yes, that's who she's named after, so what can I tell you? And I have a little 1.5-year-old, Penelope Sue. And my son Cameron is a stay-at-home dad, guys. This is God's way of really getting back at him. The way he was as a child, because now he's outnumbered in the house. He's got two little girls, and he's got a wife who comes home at the end of the day because she's working. So he's outnumbered like 3-1. And when we get together, we are outnumbered collectively 5-2. So what can I tell you? On Sundays, I take him to a movie. It's guy day for Cameron and I. We go to movies. We go to roughshod movies just to feel like real men on Sundays. Gets him out of the house and gets some adult conversation instead of talking to a 3-year-old or a 1-year-old on a regular basis. But really proud of him. In fact, I told my son that I said, if you weren't my son, I'd want to be yours. He's really that good of a dad. And I don't know where he got it. It must have been from his mother. What can I tell you? But it's great to be here and to be visiting again with high school group coming up here to learn more about conservative politics, learn about my father, be able to go to the ranch and visit the ranch and just see how he lived. Because so many people who have visited the ranch or go up there for the first time expect to see this palatial palace. My God, it's Ronald Reagan's. It's got to be 400,000 square feet. It's got to have everything in the world. And you go up there and you go, is this like where the help stayed? And they did. They were Ronald and Nancy Reagan. They were the help. And so you're going to be able to see that, just see how the way they really were, the way my dad really was. In fact, those of you who have never known Ronald Reagan as far as getting close to him, as far as reading books or whatever, your parents have had thoughts about him, probably told you things about Ronald Reagan. What you'll find out is when you walk into the ranch, everything that you believed about Ronald Reagan will hit you in the face and you'll go, oh my God, I was right. Because that's how that house will affect you. It is so Ronald Reagan. And if you ever went on the Ronald Reagan Trail in Illinois and visited the homes he was raised in Illinois, Tampico and Dixon, what have you, all those houses look alike. They were all simple, and it's just Ronald Reagan. How he was raised, he never forgot his roots, and who he was. And he passed that down through most of the family. Just saying, okay? Just saying. But I want you all to remember something. I was thinking about this at the table. A lot of talk about, want to learn about and talk about abortion and what have you and all these different issues that come up. I want you to think about this, though, because this is not something you will not learn in school. And that's what's great about this weekend. You're going to learn things here from these great speakers that you're not going to get in school. As I said to Don Lemon one night on CNN, I said, you think the history of the country started this morning when you got out of bed? They had no concept of what happened before that day. And that's what's so sad is when they come up with the news, that's the only news they give you. They give you nothing to connect the dot. And what Young America's Foundation does and what these speakers will do is connect the dot. That'll help you in those debates you're going to have with others at your school and in your everyday life. But think about this. Think about it. It's August 12th, 1961. All right? You go to school. You have a great day at school. And you come home to your mom and your dad. You're living in Berlin. You're in Germany. And you say to your mom, you know, Mom, Aunt Sophie has asked me to come to her house tonight and have dinner and go to a movie. And your mom says to you, oh, honey, that's great. You have a wonderful time. And if it gets to be too late, darling, spend the night and we'll see you tomorrow. It's August 12th, 1961. So you go to Aunt Sophie's and you go to a movie. It's a wonderful movie. You have dinner with Aunt Sophie. It gets to be late. You spend the night. You know when you come home? 1989. That's when you come home. That's how quickly you can lose your freedom. And if America keeps on going down the road that we're headed today, that could be happening to you. It happened in 1961. It could certainly happen again. Ask those in Ukraine. Ask those in Crimea. How quickly you can lose your freedom. You're all young. You're high school students. But think about this also. If you went now to visit the Ukraine, you went to visit Poland, you went to visit those areas of the world, do you realize 2019, this is the 30th year of freedom? This generation that was born 30 years ago has only been free for 30 years. You were born into freedom. Your parents were born into freedom. Your grandparents were most likely born into freedom. Your great-grandparents are probably born into freedom. But if you lived in that area of the world 31 years ago, you weren't free. 40 years ago, you weren't free. You became free in 1989. And one of the reasons you became free in 1989 was because of a guy named Ronald Reagan, who stood up to the Soviet Union. And on June 12th of 1987, gave one of the great speeches of his lifetime, where he said, tear down this wall. Nobody knew then that just a couple years later, that wall would come down and freedom would break out throughout the world. I was lucky enough this summer, because my wife owns a travel business that takes people all over the world all year long, along with sending people all around the world other than our group. And we're able to go to that area of the world this year, and we were in Budapest, and able to go to Liberty Square where they have a statue of my father and have our picture taken with the statue of my father, because that's who they credit for them being free. Freedom, as my father said, is something that's just not passed down. It's something that needs to be fought for. And if we want to keep our freedoms that we have, maintain them, or get them back, we have to fight for them. Or you're not going to have the freedoms I had during my lifetime. And where did I learn those things? I didn't have Young America's Foundation. Didn't exist. I had Ronald Reagan. Sitting in a car, riding out to the ranch. Now, this is my dad's third ranch. He had two ranches before this that I grew up on. And if you wanted to spend time with my father, it wasn't at a baseball game. It wasn't at a football game. It wasn't fishing. It was on the back of a horse, or it was in a car riding out to the ranch on any given Saturday. Or my father would regale me with stories about America. Regale me with stories about the military, the Army, the Navy, the Marines. And I would listen to him sing all of the songs, all of the anthems, every Saturday as we went out to the ranch. And would just tell me stories about America. Now, I was a kid. Like most kids at that time, you think, will this guy ever shut up? I'm trying to get him to listen to real music like rock and roll, like the Beach Boys, and he keeps on turning on to something with Little Brown Jug and what have you. And I'm thinking of jumping out of the car. But this is what my dad did. My dad told stories. And if you go back, and I would suggest this, listen to his speeches that he's given. And if you really listen to him, what you're going to hear is Ronald Reagan speaking to us in parables. That's what he did. You didn't just hear his speech when he spoke. You felt it. You internalized it. And today, if you go back and you listen to A Time for Choosing, or you listen to the speech he gave on the 40th anniversary of D-Day at Point de Hoc, where I was just a month ago, you feel it. He spoke to us in parables. He told us stories that made us feel good about ourselves, made us feel good about this country, and he always uplifted the United States of America. And that's what's so great about conservatism. We are the only ones that uplift the United States of America and see the greatness that we are. It's only been the liberals who have ever pointed a finger at America and blamed us for everything known to mankind. But as the story goes, the only property we've only ever asked for is enough land to bury our dead after the battle. We don't take other properties. We just want enough land to bury those who are willing to give their all for the freedom of others. Growing up in my dad's household was something. I had a mom and a dad who had a value system second to none. My mother was born in St. Joe, Missouri, and brought that with her to California. My father in Illinois brought that with her to California. I praise God that they didn't meet till they got here. Otherwise, I would have had to move. I got to enjoy California weather from the very beginning of life. I didn't have to be in the snow first and then say, I got to get out of here. But they met here. And I was brought into the family differently than anybody else in the family. I was adopted into the family. And so I tell people, I said, what's great about being adoption, if the Reagans don't adopt, they don't have a conservative son. So anybody who's ever thinking of adopting, we're all conservative, we adoptees. And think about the Reagan family. I tell this story when I go out and I speak to abortion groups and pro-life groups, I should say. And it's this, I tell the story about Sarah Jane Folks, Nancy Robbins, Rita Marembi, and John L. Flar. And the story I tell is really simple. You take Nancy Robbins, for example. Nancy Robbins, the day she was born, her father walked out on the family. Walked out on the family. 7 years later, she would be adopted after her mother got remarried. Sarah Jane Faulks was born Sarah Jane Maysfield. Parents couldn't afford her, didn't know what to do with her. So they left her on the doorstep of the next door neighbor, the Faulks family, who took her off the doorstep, literally took her off the doorstep, brought her in, and raised her as Sarah Jane Faulks. Rita Marembi was born to a bush girl in Uganda and ended up in an orphanage in Uganda at a very young age, I think 3. John L. Flar's mother had a relationship with a married man in Ohio, got herself pregnant. He joined the military to get away, and he didn't want to tell his wife what he had done, so he decided to join the military. And she came to California and had that baby of hers. Now, who are these? Because when you think about pro-life, you got to really tell the stories and say, okay, if this hadn't happened, where would we be? So let's look at these lives. And let's take a good look. Let's look at Nancy Robbins. Nancy Robbins' father leaves her at birth. Her mother remarries a man by the name of Dr. Loyal Davis. She becomes Nancy Davis and ends up becoming the First Lady of the United States of America because she marries Ronald Reagan. What happens if Nancy Robbins is never born? What happens? Sarah Jane Maysfield, who becomes Sarah Jane Faulks. What happens to her life? She comes to California and becomes an actress. Like many actresses, she changes her name. Changes it to Jane Wyman, who becomes an Academy Award-winning actress and the first wife of Ronald Reagan and my mother. What about Rita Marembi? Rita Marembi, child born in Uganda to a bush mother who was 13, a young lady walks into that orphanage one day, sent there by her father, the President of the United States, and this young lady, my sister Maureen, falls madly in love with this little girl and adopts her. And Rita Marembi becomes Rita Marembi Reagan and lives in the United States up in Sacramento, has come to the YAF conferences a couple of times. And John L. Flar, who's he? He's your speaker tonight, Mike Reagan. If none of us had been born, where would we be? Where would Ronald Reagan have been? Where would I have been? Where would Rita have been? Where had Nancy been? So what happens is when you're out and you're really speaking to people, you need to tell the story. You need to speak in parables so people understand. If you're trained to be a docent, what's the backstory? How did we get here? And so many times, all you get is get the headlines, and you don't get the story that goes with the headlines. And that's really what I learned from my father, who would sit me down and really explain behind the headlines how we got here. Talk to me about the military. Talk to me about education. Talk to me about so many things that when I was younger, I didn't get. And the older I got, I started to understand it because my dad got smarter or whatever. I remember when I got into talk radio. I was in talk radio for 26 years. I campaigned for my father in 1960s for governor, thinking I'd get a good paying government job if he won. And then I found out he didn't believe in nepotism. I thought about changing my vote because the other guy did believe in nepotism, and we just got rid of the other Brown. But it's those things that you really, the things you go through. But I remember doing my radio show one day. I campaigned for my dad so much. I knew what he thought before he thought it. If he asked me a question, I could answer it because I knew where it came from. I knew the depth of Ronald Reagan. I'd heard it so often, it was easy to answer the questions. Maureen and I could both do that. And we did it all the time on the campaign trail. 1965 for governor, 1970s for president, 1980 for president. 1980, I think the last month in 1980, I took 66 airplane rides in 19 states campaigning and what have you. But I remember one day doing radio, somebody called me on the phone. Long-time listener, first-time caller. Gosh, those come in all the time. Expect God to call one day and say, long-time listener, first-time caller. But the caller said to me, okay, you answered the question. That's how your father believes. But why do you believe it? And I realized at that moment in time, I believed it because my dad believed it. And I realized I didn't take the time to find out why I believed it in my soul and in my heart. And I think that's what you've got to do also. Don't believe something simply because dad believed it or mom believed it, because then you'll never win an argument because that's the only thing you know. I believe this because I was raised conservative, and so that's why I believe it. But if you want to win the arguments, know why you believe it. My dad knew what he believed and why he believed it. In order for you to win the arguments, you got to know what you believe and why you believe it. Then you'll win the arguments. You won't be backed into a corner trying to figure out what would dad say? What would mom say? You'll know to say the right thing because you've got that knowledge, that background, that knowledge. One thing my dad did, which is probably the most important thing he did, you know, we didn't have, back in that day, we certainly didn't have social media. He had radio and sometimes a flickering television set. But my dad, even though he would listen to radio because he became a radio announcer ultimately, he read. He read. He gained knowledge. And I've said this before at these meetings. Readers are leaders. If you're a reader and you read profusely, you'll be a leader because you'll have more knowledge than anyone else. When you go to the ranch and you see the books in his little library there, and you'll see copies of them upstairs. You know, I grew up, you know, him having the library at the house. So many people will have books in a library that they've never cracked open just to show you, look, we're important. But my dad read every one of his books and didn't just read it once, read it twice. He became a Christian because he read a book. That's how he became a Christian. It wasn't that his mother went to him, who was a Sunday school teacher. He read a book, and it so affected him that he accepted Christ. Changed his life. So think about those things. Think about the fact readers are leaders. And listen to your speakers this weekend. But read also what they've written and what other leaders have written, so you have a vast knowledge of the issues. So when somebody on television says, oh my God, the Russians were trying to be involved in the 2016 election, you could say, and in 1980, and 1984, it's like, what year were they not trying to be involved in our elections? I mean, they make it sound like it's a news story. It's like an old story. You know, when they tell you, oh my God, the President of the United States spoke to the President of the Ukraine. Yes, that's what presidents do. You know, and you say, well, how did we get in the Second World War? Who was leading England at that time? And did he make a call to Roosevelt and say, we need you over here? Can you do me a favor? Or when we went into Grenada, the Organization of American States calling the president saying, you know, we really need your help in Grenada. Can America come in and save these people? I mean, this is, excuse me, but at that level, these how these people speak and talk on a regular basis. But the media treats it because they so hate the president, like, oh my God, can you believe? And the media doesn't give you backstory. Say, wait a minute. Guys, this has been going on. This is how leaders speak to each other on a regular basis. You know, like Ronald Reagan had to build a friendship with Mikhail Gorbachev before walls started coming down. He had to pull him aside, get him together in a boathouse, just him and Mikhail Gorbachev speaking. I don't care what they said. What was the end result? The end result is the Berlin Wall came down and people became free. I think too often we're asking for too much knowledge, all this transparency talk, but we don't have the knowledge to understand why all that's going on. And I think transparency sometimes is good, but other times it gets confusing and the media then uses it to sell you that something dastardly is happening in the world that we, in fact, live in. And that's not really always the case. I guess it's the case if you hate the president enough, you can make that argument. But it's sad to see what's going on in America that we live in today. My dad would be just taken aback by what the media has done. But the media also did not treat him well. But my dad took care of it in a different way. He took care of it with his humor, because that's what my dad had. He had a great sense of humor. That's how he relaxed people in his presence who might have been nervous being around him. Like on the day he was shot, what does he say to Nancy? I forgot to duck. What does he say to the doctors in the operating room? You know, I hope you're all Republicans. You know, what does he say to his son who walks in at 10 o'clock the next morning? Michael, if you're ever going to get shot, don't be wearing a new suit. I said, why? He said, because the last time I saw it, they cut that suit off of me, put it in the corner of the hospital room. It was in shreds, and it was a brand new suit. He says, so if you're ever going to get shot, Michael, don't be wearing a new suit. I said, I won't. He said, young man who shot me, Hinckley. I said, yes, John Hinckley. He says, parents in the oil business? Yep. I understand they live in Denver? Yep. Do you think they have any money, Michael? I said, well, I think they have money. Oil business, Denver. He said, do you think they'd ever buy me a new suit? So he diffused things with his great humor, what he's able to do. He taught me a lot of lessons growing up. Taught me about America. Showed me how to be a father. Showed me so many great things that it took me a while before I ultimately got them all. But my mother was there also. Two great parents from the Midwest raising me, and that was not easy. But I think it turned out, you know, pretty good in the end. Got a great wife, great family, great friends. And it's nice to be around young people who love Ronald Reagan and hear people speak about him, want to learn about him. And when you see that ranch tomorrow or the next day, you're going to find out as I did. You're going to hear the songs. You're going to hear the stories. You're going to feel them as you go through. And you're going to love Ronald Reagan even more on Friday afternoon than you might love him today. So enjoy your trip to the ranch. Enjoy this weekend you're going to have with Young America's Foundation. You're going to learn a lot. You've got great speakers, great people coming up here, great knowledge. But remember again, readers are leaders. Go home and read everything you can. And read about the other side also so you know their argument and what it's going to be. But know why you believe it. So like Ronald Reagan, you know what you believe, you know why you believe it. Have a wonderful, wonderful weekend. Enjoy the rest of it. And I'm leaving tomorrow morning. for those in Ohio, I will be at the Ohio State-Michigan State game at the Shoe on Saturday in Ohio. So there you go. Went to Loyola High School. All of a sudden I feel a friend. My wife was born and raised in Omaha, Nebraska, 1 of 12, and then she left. She woke up one morning and said, I've scraped my last windshield, Mom and Dad. I'm out of here. So she came to California, and I grabbed her before she could go any further. So again, thank you so much. And I guess we have some questions.
Question. You may line up in the back over here, but we're going to start with a question from one of our virtual past viewers. Barry from Phoenix, Arizona asks, how do you envision the conservative movement will change after President Trump is no longer in office? Will it continue to move in a populist direction, or will it revert to the time of Ronald Reagan in the 1980s?
Boy, you know, that is a very good question. I think one of the problems that sometimes we have as conservatives is really, and you're here for a reason, is really nurturing and growing the next leader. Conservatives are led by ideology, a leader, or an enemy. So if we have a common enemy, we all come together as one. If we have a leader, we come together like Trump now is the leader, and we follow that person. We have what we believe, but conservatism, you can make arguments. Are you social conservative? Are you economic conservative? And you go down the line. So what we haven't done in the past is really build up the next leader, the next person who's going to take that position. And I don't know who that person might be. In the future, will it be the vice president who's there now? Will it not be the vice president? But I like to really pay more attention instead of on the national level. I'm trying to find a new leader in the state of California because we, in a word, suck in this state. And so again, it's about finding that next leader. And I don't know who that next leader is going to be, because right now, Donald Trump basically sucks all the air out of the room. And so is there room for somebody else to come through the system? I don't know. I don't know where it's going to revert to, but I will tell you, if it reverts back to Ronald Reagan, not bad.
Hi, Mr. Reagan. I'm Ivan Hamilton. I'm Gustin Marcos. I'm going to Bishop Diego High School, and I have a question. Do you talk politics on the dinner table, and do you disagree with Reagan on some issues?
Oh, did we with my dad?
Yes.
Not that often. We tried to talk about before we got to the dinner table, because remember we had others in the room. I mean, Patty and Ron, liberal, not really great supporters of their father. In that era, politics, but they're also raised in the 60s. And I tell people this. I just had lunch with Patty the other day, and I tell people this because I spent 20 years basically riding out to the ranch with my father, listening to the stories, riding horses, shooting ground squirrels and rabbits and everything else at the ranch, and just hearing the stories. I was born in 1945. Patty is going to be 67 in October. She's born in what, 1952. Ron was born in 1958. So think about yourself, young ladies, really, and guys too. Think about you being 14 years old and your dad decides to run for political office. Now you may get all giddy and think, oh, this is wonderful. But the good news is your dad won. The bad news is your dad won. Because now you move from all your friends, you're taken to Sacramento, put into another school. I don't know a 13, 14-year-old girl who wants to leave her friends that she's going to school with and go somewhere else and try to make new friends. I don't know anybody like that. And I think that has an effect on you as a child, or Ron, who was seven, you know, when that happened. And so I think it tends to get to a point where you have to affix blame. We always like to affix blame to someone other than ourselves. And just point a finger and say, it's those conservatives, it's their fault they elected him. Those Christians elected him. That's their fault. It's their fault my dad's no longer riding horses with me or going out to the ranch with me. And I think that tells a lot about what you have to go through. It's not easy being raised in a family of icons. And I tell people, my sister Maureen and I, who are from Jane and Dad, Jane, my mom, we're the only two people ever born and or raised by two people who one would go on to become President of the United States and the other one would go on to become an Academy Award winning actress with two stars in the Hollywood Walk of Fame, handprints of footprints of Grauman's Chinese, and four Golden Globes. No one else has lived that life except for Maureen and I. And so, you know, if anything, at the dinner table, you're trying to fight for your own moment. I mean, you're saying, can I speak now? Okay, you're an actress, you're an actor. Okay, great, congratulations, I saw the movie. Can I have the potatoes? And so a lot of times you didn't want to speak about politics at the table, Dad and Nancy, you want to speak about family, how you doing, how you feeling, or whatever. You did politics, it was usually in the living room, in the den, prior to that.
Hi, my name is Juana Salas, and I'm from Illinois as well, so it's nice to know that something good can come out of the good old corrupt state of Illinois. So,
think about this. Let me tell you this. I spoke at Eureka College on June 5th. Every year, June 5th, they celebrate my father as the day he passed away. And I was speaking there, I was reminding the people at Eureka College, but think about this for a second, because I know kids think about these things. You go through high school, where am I going to go to college? Oh my God, do I go here, do I go there? What's going to be best for me, what's not going to be good for me? Think about this. During the 80s, you have people back in Washington who went to Stanford, Harvard, Yale, name the university. Georgetown, Chicago, University of Chicago Economics, right? And you're asking them questions. You know what they're saying to you? Don't ask me. Ask the kid that went to Eureka. Well, think about that for a minute. Kid that went to a school with 600 students who gets a degree in economics is telling the kids from Yale, Harvard, you name it, telling them what to do for 8 years in Washington, D.C. It doesn't matter where you go to school. It matters what's here. And Ronald Reagan proved that here really, really mattered. Go ahead.
This is kind of unrelated to your speech, but I am aware that your father granted amnesty to, I believe, around 2 million undocumented immigrants through the program IRCA that would toughen up, like, the southern border. Do you think that granting amnesty to the millions of illegal immigrants that live here is the way to secure our borders because it was deemed ineffective by, like, a lot of historians and politicians?
I think what people miss today is, I think something needs to be done. I think my father would work certainly with DACA and that situation, which I think needs to be taken care of. He would never hold the children responsible for parents. I have a Latina daughter-in-law. I have two Latina granddaughters. And things have changed since 1980s. We have a lot. There's a lot more families now that have relatives in the family that are Latinas than what was going on back in the 1980s. What my father would probably do, what needs to be done, is somebody needs to take charge, bring those people in the Oval Office and say, okay, where do we agree? Let's take the area we agree on, let's get that passed. And then let's worry about the other stuff later on, but let's get something done. Because my feeling is that you have two sides right now who are using illegals as a weapon against each other. And they're the, and we're all being hurt by what is going on. And nobody's giving in. In politics is the art of negotiation. You're never going to get everything you want, but you've got to be willing to give up something. And at this point, nobody's giving up anything. And there's a lot of suffering going on because of it. And I think that if the Republican Party and the Democrat Party don't find a way to come together, and it's going to take the president sitting down and doing it, then it's not going to get better for anybody in the future. And I am saddened when I see children who were brought here by their parents as babies being used as pawns, and they shouldn't be used as pawns. Something needs to be done for them. And I think the president has some ideas, but with this Congress of the United States, of it's all about impeachment, not getting things done. It's hurtful to a lot of people. And when you have the media who will affix blame to anybody other than, where it needs to be, it is sad. You're fighting the media all the way down the line. But my father, when he signed Simpson-Mazzoli back in 1986, the Democrats did promise to shore up the border. My dad did his part, and as I say when I tweet at Reagan World, I hashtag 33, because it's been 33 years since anybody's done anything on the border, and something needs to be done. So it's a time the Democrats fulfill their end of the agreement and shore up the border as they promised to do in 1986 when my dad offered amnesty.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Good evening, Mr. Reagan.
Hi.
I was at my chapter, YEF chapter on my campus, I've often had questions from people along the lines of, why would you support Ronald Reagan? He was a racist. So I was wondering.
He was a what?
Racist. I personally think that is just absurd.
Well, I've never heard that one.
Yeah, I think it's absurd. So I was wondering, what do you think would be the best defense to those people?
It's a lie. I mean, you don't defend it, it's just a lie. Where does that show up? This is what happens with social media. Somebody on social media sitting in their underwear in their parents' basement with three followers going, yeah, Ronald Reagan was a rapist, you know. And I heard it from my mother. And all of a sudden it becomes, that's the deal. No. Well, Ronald Reagan, no. No, I've never heard that one. No.
I was surprised too. Thank you very much.
Yeah, just.
Hi there. So you talked about how your father was a really big reader. So I was just wondering, like, what kind of books would he recommend, or what kind of books, you know, you would recommend to read?
What was that now?
Oh, you mentioned how your father.
Oh, what kind of reader? I mean,
yeah.
He read. I mean, just go upstairs because it's a lot there. History. He read so many books dealing with history. He had like a photographic memory with this stuff, so he read it and really retained it. History. The History of the English-Speaking People is a great set of books by Winston Churchill. That's a great series to read. The Bible. I mean, he actually read the Bible. He didn't, like, have one in his, you know. He actually read it. There's so many books in there. I can't think of all of them now, but there's upstairs. They'll have them. You'll see them at the ranch. Whatever, but history is so important to really know, so you know where you came from, so you know where you can stop us from going again. And we're headed down a road because you have the media really selling the youth how great socialism is, how wonderful it is. Ask somebody from Ukraine, how is socialism? By the way, it was so good, why are you here? I mean, that's all you got to do is say, why are all these people here that were living, what are they doing? Why did they come here? It was so great. Because it's not great. And it, it's it's really something. And unfortunately, some of those places, like the Czech Republic, you know, in many ways reverts back because that's all they know. And so they have elections now, and they elect people who are communists because that's all they know. We don't do a good job ourselves in America after we win of really telling the story and really educating. The reason I got involved in Berlin, we have a plaque at the Brandenburg Gate. We have a Reagan Center we built at the Checkpoint Charlie Museum in Berlin, is because I was in Berlin visiting, and I was standing there where the Berlin Wall used to be, and I asked a young teenage young boy, I said, what do you know about the Berlin Wall? And he said, well, the Americans put it up to keep the communists out of their sector. And I went, really? I didn't know that. You know, explain that to me. But that's what he believed. Because what we Americans have done too often, we'll do that and expect people are just going to applaud as we leave the building. And then they're going to take care of everything. And they don't. We leave, and things revert back if you don't do anything, if you don't fight for it. They revert back. The reason I'm doing stuff at Normandy, France, where the brick project that we have commemorating those who fought in the Second World War in the European theater is because I was invited to raise the flag at the American Cemetery at Normandy a few years ago. I was playing golf with a 28-year-old young man who managed a restaurant by where I live, and we were just talking, and he said, what do you do? I said, well, I said, you know, tomorrow I'm leaving for Paris, France. Next day I'm going out to Normandy, and I'm raising the American flag at the American Cemetery at Normandy on Sunday. And he says to me, why is there an American cemetery at Normandy? No idea. Nobody taught that. Nobody said anything in school about that. There's no page on the American, you know, about Normandy and about the cemetery at Normandy, France. He had no idea. I finally just said to him, I said, do you think D-Day was when your report card came home? I mean, hello. So now we're doing things at Normandy, France. We have a Ronald Reagan Center we built and all these things. But again, it's just educating and doing these things. I spoke at an event a few years ago at Azusa Pacific College. And a minister got up to introduce me and was talking about prayer in school. Prayer in school is the greatest thing in the world. Prayer in school, that's what we need. Your father was for it. My God. And you have 400 people there. Yeah, great. So I'm speaking. And I said, I need to ask a question. 400 people. I said, how many of you in this place have children today in K through 8? About 70, 80 hands went up. I said, that's great, isn't it? I said, let me ask you a question. How many of you prayed with your children today before they left for school? Every hand went down. Sometimes we conservatives think that somebody else is going to do the job for us. We want prayer in school, but we're not going to pray with our kids before they leave for school. That's stupid. I mean, that's just, you're dropping the ball as a parent. So don't yell at the school because they're not praying in school if you're not praying at home. And so it's so important that we do educate and that when we go into Berlin and we bring down the Berlin Wall, that we're there until we had the plaque put in the ground at the Brandenburg Gate and put in the Reagan exhibit at the Checkpoint Charlie Museum. There was no mention of Ronald Reagan in Berlin. You couldn't find his name. You could find Kennedy, but you couldn't find anything on Ronald Reagan. And that offended me. So we made a package with Checkpoint Charlie Museum, overlooking Checkpoint Charlie now, big Ronald Reagan exhibit. The speech he gave June 12, 1987 is displayed there. Now a plaque in the ground between the Brandenburg Gate and the Adlon Hotel. We've got to do that. We can't drop the ball. You can't just walk out of the room and think people are going to get it. My sister told me in 1965, campaigning for my father for governor, I said, what's the difference between a Democrat and Republican, Merm? She said, that's simple. Democrats go to bed every night hoping you never get it. Republicans go to bed every night hoping someday you do. And that's still the truth today. You can't go to bed hoping we're going to wake up tomorrow and figure it out. You got to help people figure it out.
Thank you. Thank you.
I feel like I'm back in talk radio. I haven't hung up on anybody yet, thinking about it.
Hi, I'm Charlotte. I go to Skyline High School. And I was just wondering, is there a certain way that your father would cheer you up if you were having like a bad day or something, or like your family members?
No, my father married strong women. He was always the good guy. We always hated the mothers. Dad was a piece of cake. Piece of cake. My mother had the riding crop. You know, 10 times back of each leg. You know, she only did it once. Dad was easy. You never wanted to go to. I had Jane, Patty and Ron had Nancy. So, you know, the angst was with, I don't want to talk to Mom. Dad, because Dad would never raise a finger. Oh, yeah. Dad was, the only people he ever got mad at were the Russians. You know, he was a piece of cake. Piece of cake. Yeah. Easy guy. Yeah.
Thank you.
I was doing radio one day and somebody said, okay, Reagan, you think you've got the answer to everything? What would you do to solve the problems in the world? I said, if you were president, what would you do? I said, the first executive order, I'd put a nun in every classroom. Second executive order, I'd put a ruler in her hand. I'm telling you, nothing like a mad nun with a ruler. I'm telling you, you straighten out this country in about 6 months.
Our last question tonight is from another virtual past participant. Cody from Los Angeles asks, how did your father become conservative despite his background in Hollywood and living in California?
Well, he was actually raised in Illinois, which was conservative at the time. And he came to California, president of the Screen Actors Guild, fought communism in California, in the industry, if you will. That's where he first became involved with communism and coming into Hollywood, as could make that argument they're there today, alive and well, if you will. He was always conservative. As he said back in 1960s, he said, I didn't leave the party left me. The Democrat Party, John F. Kennedy would be a conservative Republican today. I mean, John F. Kennedy back in the 1960s, remember, was pro-military, pro-tax breaks, you know, pro-business. Could he get nominated today as a Democrat? No way. He would make the same statement today my dad made back in 1960s, that the party left him, he didn't leave the party. So my dad didn't change. My dad stayed true to his, at that time, liberal feelings. But back in the 1960s, liberals were basically the conservative today, if you really want to check out and the dictionaries and read all the information. So he didn't change. It's the party changed. And he changed parties back in the 1960s. The first Republican in the family was my sister Maureen, who browbeat him into becoming a Republican. And he did that. My sister Maureen also, God bless her, died of melanoma at 60 years old in 2001. My sister Maureen is responsible for Sandra Day O'Connor being on the Supreme Court. And how that happened was, my sister was a great supporter of the Equal Rights Amendment. Back in the 1980s, to be somebody who was supportive of the Equal Rights Amendment and being a Republican was not, they didn't go well together. And my sister was out speaking on behalf of the Equal Rights Amendment and also campaigning for our father. And so the campaign staff called my sister in to have a meeting with the staff and our father. And my father was here and the staff was here, and they were saying to my sister Maureen, if you ever met Maureen, God bless her, right now you'd be outnumbered. And they were outnumbered in that room. They didn't know it, but they were outnumbered. And they had this conversation with Maureen. Maureen, you can't be supporting the Equal Rights Amendment and go speaking to Republican women and helping your father. How can we get you off the trail of supporting the Equal Rights Amendment? We've got to do that. And my sister said, well, that's very simple. If you can get your candidate, just like that, if you can get your candidate to guarantee me this first appointment to the Supreme Court will be a woman if he's elected, I will stop campaigning for the Equal Rights Amendment. Their candidate, and her father said, deal. Maureen turns to her father, and they shake hands, and they make that deal in that room that day. Now, we're in the primary system. We haven't even got to winning the nomination yet. But they made that agreement with each other. Maureen came off the Equal Rights Amendment programs. No more speeches. We're now at the convention in Detroit, and my sister, or I'm sorry, we're at the inauguration in Washington, and my sister's got this big ERA button on. And the staff is going, oh my God, this is the last thing we need. She's gone back on her word. And if you got really close to it, it said, elect Reagan anyway. So that is how Sandra Day O'Connor, my dad, that's another thing my dad did. If my dad told you something, you could take it to the bank. He was going to take it. He was good for his word no matter what he said. And he promised his sister, his daughter, my sister Maureen, he would do that. They made that deal, and Sandra Day O'Connor was the first woman on the Supreme Court of our land. Thank you for Maureen Reagan. Anyway, thank you again.
So you want your safe space. The last thing you want is somebody invading your campus. You should always feel like you're right.
Freedom is not an abstraction. It affects our happiness and our ability to flourish.
It is very seldom that liberty of any kind is lost all at once. It's always lost bit by bit.
If we have protection of freedom of speech, if we said only things that other people liked, we'd have no reason to protect it.
Notice that when Jefferson looks for a source of our rights, can only find one, and that's the Creator.
We are a country that respects religious liberty. That key value has been enshrined in our founding documents.
We are created equal in the eyes of God, the core principle of democracy.
To believe that Islam is a religion of peace is to believe that Muslims throughout history have misunderstood their own religion.
Life is the most fundamental right. None of the other rights that are listed in the Bill of Rights actually exist without first the right to life.
Free markets fundamentally run on service, not to make everyone's outcomes equal. We are diverse people with diverse skills and diverse talents.
Femininity is one of the graces of our world, one of the things that makes life worth living. Feminism has sucked all the joy out of that.
They've attacked manliness itself. They've attacked the virtues. Virtue comes from vir, it means man.
To pretend that a man is a woman, if he believes he is a woman, nobody should be mistreated. But that's not the same thing as requiring that people say objectively untrue things. If I believe I am something that I am not, it does not make me that thing.